It is time to get started. To settle down. This is the time when I continue the lecture. I want to connect to my list of top 10 false explanations of what fascism is all about. My favorite, my top one on the list is that it is somehow a matter of a lack of civility, and that to deal with fascism is to insist on proper, respectful, civil in discourse in society. My experience with that, of course, as a student of German fascism and of the interwar period, I had long known Tucholsky's poem, Rosen auf den Weg gestreut, and I'm going to play you Hans Eisler's rendition of that again in a minute. But when I first critiqued fascism in this country publicly, and when that gained a lot of attention but no engagement, when I said after Mr. Trump had labeled the press as enemies of the people, in another clear nod to fascist predecessor, after he had already given a shout out to the pro-fascist 1930s America First Committee in the framing of his inauguration speech, and after initiating proceedings where it was clear that ultimately to remove 11 million people from the country in what one of Mr. Trump's big fans, the white supremacist Richard Spencer, called gentle ethnic cleansing. In addition to that, the removal of Muslims from people who could be admitted here. All of these things, in a, you know, not to speak of the social Darwinism, the militantly anti-labor and anti-communist ideas, and the pure neo-Nazi propaganda that it is immigrants who are stealing your jobs, who are bringing in disease, and who are a threat to your women and children. All of these things together led me to conclude that in order to save American democracy, Trump must hang. Because if not, there is a clear line draw. And if there is not repression to meet the threat, if democracy does not defend itself, then it is going to end. It is going to be ended by people who are explicitly setting out to end it. And that has been part of the consensus in Germany post-World War II, for better or worse. Whether or not the country has lived up to that is a whole other matter. But the idea that you have to stop it in its tracks, you have to nip it in the bud, and that this requires a concerted effort by all of civil society, intellectuals, teachers, corporations, municipalities, schools, what have you. And that you cannot just remain neutral and laugh it off and wait for it to play out naturally. But the very last thing that you should do is to try and placate fascism, is to try and make light of it, or to give it the benefit of the doubt. So there were two responses to the vicious, violent reaction to my statement that led the far right to demand my removal ultimately from this country, from my job, and if they had their way from this world. There were two responses from liberals to this and by the leadership of this university. One was to say, well, this was a very rude thing of you to say. And two, we're sorry that he said that and we apologize. As you might recall, maybe you don't, Joseph Castro spoke on Ray Appleton's show, who is a local right-wing radio agitator. Only 4 days after Appleton had devoted a whole day of programming to allowing his listeners to call in and tell him just in what specific ways they wanted me fired, arrested, deported, and killed. Joseph Castro went on that show to apologize for my words, and of course worked hard to get me fired. All this with the active and gleeful support of the Liberal Union and its leadership, and every single faculty member with tenure in this university to this day. So what was their response, though? Because clearly they felt a tingle of peril in this whole situation. Well, they thought it couldn't be them, because after all, I had, quote unquote, tweeted stupid shit on Twitter and therefore had it coming. Nevertheless, they felt that a response was needed. And what was that response? They asked the leadership of the university to institute a social media policy to specify what faculty members may and may not say in public and to remain within their rights. So there was no idea that you have a duty to speak out about certain things, which for me, with the long-standing established tradition, if you tell this to a German group of academics, of professionals, that there is no sense of the civic duty in this country, especially not among liberals who deem themselves progressive, anti-fascist, and whatnot, they need convincing. They don't believe that, because in the German context, it is so clear from the conservative, the Christian democratic side to the ex-communists. Even during the pandemic, it was the Christian conservative leader of the Bavarian conservatives, which are not part of the nationwide conservatives because they're too far to the right and toward Catholicism for that, was the one in a national candidates debate before the election to call out the AfD neo-Nazi party for their anti-vaccine and anti-mask rhetoric and link, and saying this is not about specific legitimate complaints and worries. This is about the social Darwinist and ultimately far right-wing neo-fascist worldview. So where was that here? That did not exist. It is all, oh, those dumb people who won't do the right thing. Why don't they read the studies? Why don't they know this is not us, this is not America, and so forth. So it's the wholesale abandonment of the public sphere and the incapability and unwillingness to identify as fascist what is flying in your face as evidently, obviously fascist in origin. So faculty got busy writing themselves a social media policy guideline. Then they also drafted the principles of community. I don't know if you read those. I read them and they reminded me of the kind of thing you would find hanging in the corridor of a kindergarten or primary school. No running in the hallways. Always wash your hands before and after you go to the bathroom. No loud talking during dinner, no pushing, no shoving. You should read it sometime. I critiqued that the Fresno Bee at the time was not just run by completely brain-dead people. They had a very good young woman who was critically reporting on Fresno State and actually holding, you know, their feet to the fire, who went with that story. The Chronicle of Higher Education picked it up, the criticism of saying, this is all about conduct. This is all about how you comport yourself. There's nothing even in there about the possibility of conflict or disagreement, let alone anything about fostering debate, criticism of higher-ups in society, of power structure, of any of that sort, nothing. It's all about be nice to each other, respect each other, don't step on each other's toes, support each other. Well, I do not want to support faculty members who are promoting, for instance, far-right ideas and policies. I do not want to support my fellow faculty members who are showing up at a meeting that Joseph Castro holds to say, we want Rhonda Girard fired for dissing the late Barbara Bush when she died and saying, you know, she was an amazing racist. These are not the kind of people who I'm going to support because I have a political conflict with them. And you can't make me. So Castro responded to this criticism by saying, hey, this is just, you know, guidelines. Nothing follows from that. It's not going to be mandatory. Half a year later, they printed posters with the principles of community, as in, you know, you're supposed to do this kind of thing. The two faculty who were largely responsible, Dr. Holyoke and Dr. Jenlian, for writing this drivel, responded miffed. Among other things, they were like, why didn't you say something? Why didn't you take an input in this process? Remember where I was in 2017 when you hatched this? I was being told by my employer that they wanted me either fired or dead, or wanted me to quit because I was threatened. That was literally what the provost said. So in all of this, all the faculty could do was say, well, you really shouldn't raise your voice. You really should be nice. I think it was Dr. Jenlian in sociology who wrote to me saying, isn't the best way of dealing with fascism, not that it isn't a problem, but not to pay attention? Wouldn't it give them the attention they crave and therefore make them more important if you actually engage them in public? So this is the kind of thing that I recognized from Tucholsky. But of course, there's an infinite recourse. There is no problem with fascism. If you use the F word, you're the problem. Therefore, if the fascists come for you, it's not because they're fascists, it's because you were being uncivil. So it is a self-defeating feedback loop of idiocy, which existed in this exact way in the 1930s in Germany, which prompted Kurt Tucholsky to write this brilliant satirical poem, which then Hans Eisler performed.
Ihr müsst sie lieb und nett behandeln, erschreckt sie nicht, sie sind so zart. Ihr müsst mit Palmen sie umwandeln, getreulich ihrer Eigenart. Pfeift eurem Hunde, wenn er sie ankläfft. Küsst die Faschisten, küsst die Faschisten, wo ihr sie trefft. Wenn sie in ihren Sälen hetzen, sagt ja und Amen, aber gern. Hier habt ihr mich, schlagt mich in Fetzen und prügeln sie. So lobt den Herrn, denn prügen ist doch ihr Geschäft. Küsst die Faschisten, küsst die Faschisten, wo ihr sie trefft. Und schießen sie, du lieber Himmel, schätzt ihr das Leben so hoch ein? Das ist ein Pazifistenfimmel. Wer möchte nicht gern Opfer sein? Und spürt ihr auch in eurem Bauch den Hitlerdolch tief bis zum Heft? Küsst die Faschisten, küsst die Faschisten, küsst die Faschisten, wo ihr sie trefft.
And the translation of this that I wrote dates to January 7th, the 23rd, 2017, when it was evident to me that there was no adequate response forthcoming from liberalism to the rising threat of fascism. There still isn't. I listened to Ilhan Omar, who is by many accounts one of the most advanced progressive members of Congress. Her speech to respond to her removal from a committee assignment was all based on identity categories. It is because I am a Muslim, a woman, and of color. And representation matters. And it, given the history of this country, my removal from this assignment was to be expected. In other words, there is nothing specific about this current situation. It is just the same as it has always been. And this is a dangerous mistake to think it is just business as usual. It is just white supremacy as usual, patriarchy as usual, and so forth. No, these things, as I'll argue in a future lecture in more detail, are, of course, features of a bourgeois society. But they are radicalized in ways that are a whole lot more dangerous in fascism as a governmental practice, as a movement, as an ideology, and so forth. So the incomprehension is systemic. I'm not going to repeat the poem here. I'll splice in when I read it to you on Wednesday, when I've edited the video. But the translation I did was right around the time of Trump's rise to power. I mentioned the women's marches as an example of the mass display of liberal incomprehension. So why is it that liberals seem doomed to repeat their mistakes from 1932? Why is it that I get the impression that somebody asked liberals and progressives in this country, here, this is the playbook that the Nazis follow, and this was the playbook that your democratic counterparts in 1930s Germany followed, and it did them no good. Why don't you copy that? Why don't you do the exact same thing? It only led to the Holocaust and 60 million dead people. So why is that? To quote Ilhan Omar, it is to be expected because the conditions that gave rise to fascism in the 1930s are the same conditions that give rise to fascism today. That the failure of liberals to understand fascism is rooted in the inability of liberalism to understand the conditions that give rise to it, because to understand fascism and to understand the failure of liberalism requires the same thing, to critique the conditions that give rise to both. What are those conditions? In a nutshell, capitalism. Without a critique of capitalism, we cannot understand fascism. Liberalism and fascism, in the words of the German political scientist Reinhard Kühnel, both are forms of bourgeois domination. Liberalism and fascism as systems of government, liberal democracy and fascist dictatorship, are political ways of organizing the valorization of capital in society. But the underlying social structure, the fact that commodity production for profit prevails, that we're living in a society that is set up to make that the main way in which people produce, distribute, and consume things, remains the same. And the fact that the profit from conducting economic activity washes up in private hands, and that this group of people gets to have an outsized influence on government policy, remains the same. But what seems to them at a given point in time the proper system of government to administer their joint affairs tends to vary quite a bit. The idea that liberal democracy is the only compatible form of government with capitalism as a social order is in itself ideological. It is not based in any way on historical fact. You have many, in fact, probably a majority of examples where capitalist society is organized in an authoritarian fashion, not always fascist, but certainly as a form of dictatorship, developmental or otherwise. So when Kühnel says they're both forms of bourgeois domination, that's the point. Of course, that doesn't mean that it makes no difference. Of course, that doesn't mean that you can just go with fascism. That's the lesson that communists learned in 1933. Fascism is significantly different. You're still going to get shot, but you can't get a lawyer anymore to take that to court, even if you may lose. You might walk away and be safe in your home in a liberal democracy. That is not the case anymore once fascism comes knocking. All the niceties that the fascists laugh about in their speeches, that they actively make fun of, the rule of law. Show me your ID, tell me why you're taking me away. Let me speak to a lawyer. They laugh about that. They laugh about that in your face. And that makes a huge difference. So what Kühne recognizes here, and what we should recognize when we talk about fascism, why, for instance, Adorno and Horkheimer in 1944 say, if you don't want to talk about capitalism, don't talk to me about fascism, because you can't talk about fascism without also addressing capitalism. What Kühne and others recognize is the continuity that lies in the underlying socioeconomic order. So many of the things that exist in that order are still present, albeit in a radicalized form, once you get fascist. There may be an impulse to get rid of useless eaters in any bourgeois, which is to say capitalist society. There may be a desire not to have mentally or physically disabled people consume resources and therefore to euthanize them or institutionalize them. And certainly that happens in societies as different as the Jim Crow South, where the Centers for Disease Control conduct all kinds of experiments on Black people that would make Dr. Mengele, Auschwitz's head physician, proud. And it includes social democratic Sweden, where forced sterilizations of people with disabilities was the norm, was public policy, openly. But it is in Germany where this, under fascism, can be done the most radically, the most thoroughly, and without any kind of repercussions or scruples. So the difference is that the barriers to inhumanity that can become hindrances to the inhumanity in a bourgeois society where you have a public sphere, freedom of speech, liberal democracy, courts, the rule of law, and so forth, no longer can develop any effectiveness under fascism. So whether it is Christianity, whether it is liberalism, whether it is humanism, all these ideas that say the human, the individual, is uniquely important, every single last one of us, and has rights and has dignity, and cannot be treated as a tool, cannot be treated as a means to an end, is absolutely owed to be treated as an end in and of himself or herself. You can say that, and you can hold that as the standard to a liberal democracy, but you cannot do that in fascism, where this is explicitly rejected as an assumption. There the idea is no, not all humans are worthwhile. Even the ones that we consider Aryans don't derive their worth from their individuality, but from their collective belonging to a group that is defined as an amorphous biological glob, a race. So it is a collective that is given the value, or that is denied the value in the case of, quote unquote, the racially inferior. So there is, of course, defining differences, but there is also continuity. And so the point would be, now that we're moving past, we've seen mainstream liberalism, bourgeois scholarship, academic activity as it exists in 99.9% of the cases of tenured faculty in this school. They're babes in the woods when it comes to fascism. They don't know what hit them. So all the theories that they embrace, some of which I just outlined, are signs of their incomprehension. So do we have any theories that might make sense of fascism, that might explain it, and therefore give us tools to do something about it? There are a few that I would suggest might do the trick. And I want to introduce some of them now and then elaborate on them later, giving examples of how specific things that occur under fascism can be explained with their help. For starters, first, there is an argument in various forms that fascism is a radicalized version of normality, that the things that happen under fascism are not so much unique, but are rather just the runaway parts of the inhumanity of what's normal in a capitalist society that also engages in imperial conquest, the exploitation of labor, the suppression of dissent, and in many other ways, sort of the day-to-day interactions. If you're accustomed to treating people as means to an end, that would skew your values and your actions along those lines. So we'll see a few authors who argue this in different ways. There is Aimé Césaire, for instance. There are Jeff Eli and David Blackburn, who are looking at Germany and saying, what exactly is so special? What is so exceptional about this place? And both these authors, both these books, compare Germany before and after, and during fascism rather, to Britain, to France, to the United States. And related to that is imperialism and racism as a path toward explanation, where, and here again we have Frantz Fanon, Aimé Césaire, fascism is a scandal, not because of what it does, herding people together in camps, denying them their rights, mistreating them, but because it does those things to white people. They've been doing European colonizers, democratic, monarchistic, whatever, have been doing that on a regular basis as the praxis of their colonial empires for a long time. And liberalism, some then go on to argue, in itself, with its origins in British colonial praxis in Ireland in the 18th century, actually has that written into it. I'm not sure I'm buying that, but that is an approach that is a lot more based on facts than many of the moralistic liberal takes. White supremacy, in this notion, and oftentimes in American discourse, this is used interchangeably. I suspect as a means of avoiding to use the F word. But it is, of course, also something different. White supremacy and fascism are not congruent. Nevertheless, white supremacy as a pathway to fascism, as a sub-important constitutive part of fascism, because the praxis of segregating and separating and sorting people by race are developed in the Jim Crow South, in the colonies, where you have black codes, where you have the prohibition of interracial marriage, where you have laws that govern the relations between colonizers and colonized. So in this narrative, sometimes the United States appears to be the homeland of fascism. And we can trace the praxis of German fascism to the Jim Crow South. Another approach points to reaction as a line of tradition. Reaction being a backlash that starts as soon as the Enlightenment begins a reaction against the values of equality, democracy, the rule of law, an insistence that hierarchy, obedience, tradition are the natural order of things, and that once you start dissolving the organically grown traditional bonds between people and the customs that rest on those, you're essentially deracinating people. You are plucking them from the soil whence they grew. You're making them into hybrid creatures, artificial ones. Therefore, equality, democracy, and so forth are bad ideas. And of course, fascism, I showed you the Vichy regime and said that they're going back to the time before the French Revolution. They are explicitly and aggressively reactionary. They do not want to have anything to do with the democratic revolutionary traditions of their countries. So the German flag, black, red, and gold, that never fully got adopted by Weimar, nevertheless is a democratic standard. It goes back to a student movement in the 1800s for democracy and constitutional rule. They're the ones who used that flag. It is the black, red, and white colors that are rearranged from bars to swastika on white circle on red ground in the Nazi flag that were the flags of Imperial Germany. And to go back to those is to say, we reject the democratic tradition, and with that, the Enlightenment. Now, speaking of the Enlightenment, an important approach to explaining fascism is to be found in Adorno and Horkheimer's Dialectic of Enlightenment, where, with all the repressive, reactionary ideas and practices that are to be found still in our modern, supposedly enlightened society, point to contradictions that are inherent in the Enlightenment or and in the way it was adopted and implemented in societies. Because first and foremost, it frees the bourgeoisie to do its thing. So it leads to the rise of capitalism as well as democracy. And there is a contradiction between these things. There are different ways of dealing with these contradictions. One is, in a liberal democracy, you allow in the public sphere for contradictions to continue to exist and be represented by conflicting parties that engage in debate. Whereas fascism will attempt to remove the contradictions, not by getting rid of the underlying stuff, but rather by violent means, ultimately, by the attempt to annihilate the source of the conflict and of the contradiction in ovens. Number six, also related to anti-Semitism, fascism represents a bourgeois kind of anti-capitalism, like a small-time producer, corner store and gas station owner type of way to channel resentment at big business in ways that is not actually going to challenge the power of capital, but that allows you to vent and voice some of the complaints about the symptoms. There is an overlap here also with anti-commercialism, and this goes back a long time. The idea that trade, money, working for other people, the city with its manufacturing and trading and markets and so forth are all too far removed from the good and honest basis of virtuous human society, which is the farmer. So once you get to trade and commerce, that is where the fraud, alienation, taking advantage of people comes in. And this sometimes does and sometimes doesn't overlap with anti-Semitism, because then if you plug in the Jew as the agent of commerce and the dissolution of traditional ties, you've taken that step. But there is a pre-anti-Semitic or not actively anti-Semitic variant of anti-commercialism that also fits the bill. Turning to gender, fascism with its celebration of manliness, violence, male bonding, warfare, the aesthetics of strength and power and violence, all of that constitutes a form of radicalized patriarchy, where the psychosocial damage that modernity and or capitalism have wrought on humanity are now embraced and turned back against humanity, where fascism is mostly the work of groups of misogynistic men who externalize their self-hatred through orgiastic acts of violence. Klaus Teweley is the author to discuss here, and I'm sparing you reading his two-volume work, Male Fantasies, in class, although if you ever have a lot of time, you should read it, and especially the second volume, which contains sources from groups of men who were proto-fascists and then became fascists, talking about violence, talking about warfare, about male bonding, about women and their relations with them, is a must read. And not having read that stuff, not actually having an active reception of Teweley, is a millstone around feminism in this country. I think it's a glaring omission from the curriculum. If you think you can understand fascism and not having read this, I believe you are mistaken. Of course, people don't take, feminists taking advice from a white man on this subject, you know, this is what you should read to understand patriarchy, can be dismissed sight unseen, as that is not going to happen. But see if I care. Now, anti-feminism, a backlash against advances in both gender equality and gender fluidity, like the dissolution of gender roles, where fascism is an attempt by men to regain what power they had when things were still traditional, normal, and patriarchal. So in that sense, fascism represents an attempt to violently restore patriarchy, but also to put women back in their place. So one of the warning signs for me looking at American public discourse was Gamergate. Yeah. So, and ask an academic feminist about Gamergate and see what they have to say about it. If you get a correct definition out of them, I would be surprised. If they had paid attention to it, and now people tell me, oh, you know, every feminist have been warning about fascism since 2013. The hell they have. They've been telling me until very recently that there is no such thing. Or if there is, it's a matter of crazy, stupid people on the fringes. So Gamergate is the defining moment. If somebody wants to do a presentation on that, I would be thrilled. And I knew this because I am a part-time gamer. And at one point, I was harboring dreams of becoming a developer, you know? yeah.
Now, what would be the correct definition of Gamergate?
Gamergate was when a fairly vanilla mainstream liberal feminist had some modest criticism of the role of women in gaming and in games. And she was crucified, harassed, brutally, mean, publicly, etc., and online, targeted under the capable direction of Milo Yiannopoulos, with the help of a cast of characters that included 4chan, denizens, bronies, and neo-Nazis. This is the budding Trump coalition. This is what becomes the alt-right. So if the effectiveness of the dial a death threat machine for Republicans, pick up a phone, hunt somebody out of the office, job, home, and mind, is resting in part on having this volunteer army that can be mobilized at the drop of a hat, who will get on their cell phones and phone in or text the death threats to the identified target and their employer. And that is the shit that faculty at this school here have been playing along with, as well as the administration, that they have enabled, excused, ignored, denied, and so forth. So if I have labeled them as Nazi collaborators, that's why. Because they are, it's the accurate list. So Gamergate is the thing that liberals missed, that mainstream professionals missed. They don't deal with that dirty corner of the internet, games, and, you know, young men sitting in basements on smelly couches and so forth. That is simply not something they pay attention to. By definition, that doesn't count. It's not respectable people. Nothing that these people can ever do will affect them. Well, now it is. Now you have one of these people like Mark Ruffo running Florida's education system as Reichskommissar for Education and Propaganda. And they're kicking out university presidents, they're purging faculty, they're scrubbing the curriculum and so forth. And still liberals are like, well, this is our history. Maybe they don't understand the history. Why don't they pay attention to the facts? And nobody gives a shit about your facts, you know? They're going to create the facts. That's the idea. And you have been watching this and you haven't been paying attention, and now you're getting the bill for it. So I was on forums where gamers talk in 2013, 14, even sooner than that. And I saw all this firsthand. And you would be mistaken if you believe that anybody in academia was paying attention to that. And very few people, in fact, were at all paying attention to that. And those who did mostly got it wrong. Like if you look at the New York Times, they have the occasional explainer, you know, maybe a white professional woman running a piece in the New York Times saying what to do if your child that you have neglected because you and your husband are pursuing your careers in the professional managerial class, and you've been letting the Minecraft and whatnot do the educating. What if they suddenly come to you and say feminism is a cancer? You know, what do you do then? Where did they get that idea? Well, if you had paid attention and maybe spent some time with your kids, and on a social scale, if people had paid attention to that, you know, that maybe that wouldn't have happened. But yeah, the anti-feminism at the core of the fascist mobilization, which is not just about white men, you know, like one of the brilliant people in the somewhat, you know, pompously labeled United Leftist Coalition, let's just request them. But they have a bigger Facebook presence. But a year ago said they're now also getting black men, you know, they're getting Hispanic men. He's sitting in Oklahoma. He sees this firsthand. This is not just white supremacy. This is not just white men. In spite of the fact that if you go to Berkeley, you know, you spend a semester just learning just how to say, to intone white man with the right kind of, you know, moral indignation. Identity politics doesn't get to the core of this. Anti-feminism is a whole lot more inclusive than that, bro. So, nationalism as one of the normal things that also characterize bourgeois society Well, fascism is just a radicalized form of that. That's another one of those explanations that look at, you know, variations on the theme of normality radicalized. And then finally, anti-Semitism as foreshortened anti-capitalism, an argument that is mostly that of Moshe Postone, drawing on some of the ones I previously discussed, where Auschwitz is a factory to annihilate value, which is embodied by the Jew. This goes back to Marx's chapter on the commodity fetish. By many accounts, Marx's template for critiquing ideology, like necessary false consciousness that arises in bourgeois society, with a use for also making sense of fascism. So if you study conspiracy theory, if you study many of the everyday delusions that people necessarily harbor in order to be able to function in a contradictory society, then the commodity fetish concept is a useful one to study. So I don't know if I'm going to get around to elaborating on all of these for the remaining lectures, but I'll see how many I get around to. I think next week I want to start with a relatively straight up a communist approach that says, you know, in the words of George Dimitrov, who was the chair of the Communist International in the 1930s, and the leader of the Bulgarian Communist Party, and the lawyer that defended the poor guy who was accused of setting fire to the Reichstag in Germany, who called fascism, who characterized fascism as the most advanced and vicious form of imperialism. So there is an awareness there that the racial ideology, that the exploitation and disdain for other inferior races is an important part of what makes fascism so uniquely horrific. So I think that's what we'll do. Any questions?